Okay. So it's again very good to be amongst you all once again. So it feels very much like home now. So so today the topic is gerontopsychology and mental health.
Amrita, can you just put it on slide show so the entire screen will show? Otherwise, your slides on the left side are showing.
Okay, sorry, I didn't get what you're saying.
Put it on slide mode. Slide show the full screen.
It
Yes,
is
thank you.
there.
This is
Okay.
perfect. Yes. Thank
Okay.
you.
So yeah, you can hear me, no?
Very clear.
Okay. So today the topic is gerontopsychology and mental health. Yeah. So basically, I feel that generally when it comes to some kind of a bodily injury, right from a very young age, if I get hurt, then either I apply a band-aid, or maybe if it's a bit more severe, then I maybe take a tetanus injection, or if it's all the more severe, very serious, then maybe I go to maybe an
તો કેમ
orthopedic.
ઝૂમ નહીં થતું? તમે ઇમેલમાં કરવું પડશે ચાલ.
સેના હસી
મારું ઝૂમ જ નથી
સાલે,
થતું.
કેન યુ મ્યુટ એવરીબડી પ્લીઝ? એન્ડ વેન સમબડી નીડ્સ ટુ ટોક જસ્ટ અનમ્યુટ યોર સેલ્ફ, બીકોઝ આઈ થિંક પીપલ ઇન ધ બેકગ્રાઉન્ડ આર હેવિંગ સમ પર્સનલ ઇશ્યુ. યસ અમૃતા, કન્ટિન્યુ પ્લીઝ.
યા, સો આઈ એમ સેઈંગ દેટ વેન એવર દેર ઇઝ અ બોડીલી ઇન્જુરી, વી જનરલી ટેક કેર ઓફ ઇટ. Okay, but when it comes to something which is related to the mind, or maybe I'm feeling depressed, or maybe there is some kind of a sadness, or maybe there is some kind of anxiety, what to do with those kind of feelings?
નહીં
Generally, we
હવે
know
કરો.
that we are not taught. Okay, so we generally do not consider those feelings very seriously, or maybe do something concrete about it, maybe like we do with a physical injury. Okay, so basically, how do we deal with our feelings, or how do we deal with our mental health, is something that that is not taught to us, or it is something that we have not practiced since a very young age. Okay, and that is why maybe in the later years it can pose a problem. Okay, so as I said, gerontopsychology, and I think when I spoke about gerontology, which is the subject that I have studied, which is the holistic study of older adults, so I had said that it is a multidisciplinary study, which means that all the needs which are related to the elderly are considered within that study. Okay, so I have done my master's in social gerontology, which has to do with social problems of older adults. There is gerontopsychology, regarding which I'm going to talk about, which talks about mental health needs of older adults. There is educational gerontology, which talks about what kind of learning courses need to be designed for older adults. Gerodontology, which talks about what kind of dental needs do older adults have. There is gerotechnology, which talks about what kind of technological devices are required for older adults. So what I'm trying to say is that gerontology is a vast field, okay? And we know that there are a lot of changes that take place in the later years. There are social changes, emotional changes, psychological changes, and this study basically looks into the unique mental health needs of older adults. And I think when it comes to mental health, generally we feel that physical health is okay. We generally it's okay. We go and get treatment, or we go to a doctor, and we don't have any problems talking about that. But when it comes to mental health problems, we are very hesitant. We don't want to talk about it. अरे मेरे को ये हो गया, अरे अभी, मतलब दैट इज समथिंग दैट आई कैनॉट शेयर विथ अदर्स, एंड वी जनरली फील अशेम्ड ऑफ दिस, एंड दैट इज वाई वी हेजिटेट टू मे बी टेक एनी काइंड ऑफ ट्रीटमेंट, और मे बी टॉक टू अ प्रोफेशनल अबाउट इट. बट यू नो आई मीन there's a lot of research which has been done on mental health of older adults, and like in any age, mental health is extremely important. It is important right from childhood to old age, and it is a common human experience. So it has been said in research that if I suffer from a cold, if I suffer from cough, if that is considered to be normal, natural, if that is considered to be, maybe because of the climate change, we say that, I am undergoing this problem. So even mental health problems should be considered in a similar way. Okay, so these are actually called the physical problems of the brain. Okay, so we need not shy away. If I have any mental problem, there are treatments which are available, and maybe they might not be as quick. Maybe taking a crocin, maybe 2-3 days and it'll get over. But it might take time. But there are treatments which are available. So we need to, and I think you've had quite a few sessions on psychology and counseling. So we need to make use of that. And again, we need to remember that mental health problems are a common human experience. Okay, so that is something that we need to remember. So as I said, geropsychology, and I think Mr. Saleh has also written in the poster which was there, that it is basically, it focuses on understanding, treating and improving the mental health of older adults, something that we do not pay too much attention to. And generally, we prioritize our physical health over mental health. You know, I mean, reading things about mental health, I came across this article which said that, there was this there was this movie in which I think there was Kangana Ranaut and some other actor, Rajkumar Rao. So they had released this movie, or maybe just before the release, they had this movie called Mental Hai Kya? Mental Hai Kya? So they had to change this because mental is always associated with maybe either going mad or maybe, having a very serious mental health problem. So the name of that movie was changed to Judgmental Hai Kya? Okay, so this word mental is quite considered to be taboo, and generally we generally don't want to use it, or we generally do not want to acknowledge that maybe we might have a problem. Okay, and unless and until we are going to acknowledge that we have a problem, we will not be able to do anything about it. Okay, so geropsychologists are not too common out here, but I found that there was an organization called White Swan Foundation, which is in Bengaluru, and there is a geriatric psychiatrist. Okay, so there are one or two in Mumbai also. But geropsychology, understanding the mental health needs of older adults, is not, I mean, we don't have geropsychologists out here, but that is quite a popular field in the US, and there are a lot of people who take this specialty. So what do these people do? What do geropsychologists do? They deal with problems related to aging on the societal level and at the individual level also. So at the societal level, we know that there are a lot of myths which are related to aging. Okay, so myths, which say that, older adults cannot, they should not learn maybe after the age of 60. They cannot learn after the age of 60. And there are so many other, myths which are there, which are related to aging. Okay, so geropsychologists look into this, because when it comes to myths related to aging, it is related to the socio-economic factors which are there also. So myths related to aging is something that geropsychologists deal with. Mental health issues are also very important, because in later years, depression and anxiety are quite common. So basically, how you deal with these mental health issues. Third, this is changing roles. Okay, so a lot of roles change, and how do you adjust to those changing roles? Maybe I was the MD of a company, and now maybe I'm sitting at home, and I don't have any position like that. So how do I deal with that role which has changed? Now I have grandchildren, so I have to fulfill this role of a grandfather. So how do I do that? And basically there are people, how they adjust to changing roles. I'll just give you an example. There was this, I had gone for a workshop, and there was this doctor who, quite a well-known doctor, and he introduced himself. He was, I think, about 75, 80, and he introduced himself as a flute player, bansuri player. So I was very surprised, and after the workshop, I asked him that, you being, he just said, my name is, it was something, something Patel, Dr. Patel, but he did not say doctor. He said, I am, I think Umesh Patel, something was the name. So he said, Umesh Patel, and I am a bansuri or a flute player. So I was very curious, and I went and asked him. I said, sir, you being such a renowned doctor, how come you didn't introduce yourself as a doctor? So he said that me being a flute player is something, this identity is going to be there for a very long time. Okay, I have stopped practicing, my practice has reduced greatly, so I don't identify much with that role now. Being a Bansuri player, being a flute player is something that I enjoy very much, and this identity is going to stay with me for a very long time because I intend to play the flute till the time I die. So this identity is going to stay with me, and I identify much more with this identity of mine. So I would definitely like to call myself as a flute player. So, you know, how people, adjust to the changing roles. Okay. And on the other hand, we see that, you know, maybe an MD of a company might say, you know, that he feels that he might not be anything. He does not have a position maybe after he retires. So these kind of issues can arise in old age. Okay. So another, this is retirement. So how do you adjust to retirement? And generally in research, it is said that the 2 years which are there after retirement, there are a lot of people who have a lot of physical as well as mental problems in those 2 years, and they can be so serious that they can be fatal also, that people can it has led to deaths also because they are not able to deal with that vacuum which is created in their lives. Okay, so how do you deal with issues in retirement? Reduce isolation. So what do you do? How do you reduce isolation? And I think you might be knowing that in the UK, I mean, isolation, loneliness is growing out here. And there was a survey which was done by AgeWell India. It was with around 25,000 older adults. And they found that out of two, one older adult is feeling lonely. And this loneliness issue is growing out here. And in the West, it is so serious that in the UK, they have a loneliness minister. Okay, so basically, geropsychologists deal with how do we reduce isolation? Then how do you improve your cognitive health? How do I improve my thinking? Okay, so how do I improve my thinking to the extent that it works kind of in my favor? Okay, and basically, how do I maximize the potential that is there in later life? So, as I've already said, that I have always believed that old age is a period, and older adults are people who have a lot of skills, who have a lot of potential, who have a lot of knowledge, and this needs to be used for the betterment of the society. And how this potential which they have, how that can be maximized? Okay. So that is something that is studied by geropsychologists. They also talk about, you know, why do some people have memory issues? Okay, so why do some people, why are they able to deal with aging in a better way than others? What leads to successful aging? So all these things that are related to the mental, psychological and emotional issues that a person in old age faces are dealt with by geropsychologists. Okay. Now, as I said, it deals with mental health. Okay. So now when it comes to mental health, we feel that if I don't have any kind of a mental problem, I'm all right. But a lot of research says that mental health is more than the absence of mental disorders. Just because I do not have any mental illness does not mean that I am mentally healthy. Okay, and WHO has gone to the extent that they say that there is no health without mental health. Mental health is an integral part of our health. But unfortunately, we do not pay too much of attention to mental health. Why? Because if maybe there is a mental illness or if there is a mental problem which is there, it cannot be seen. And sometimes we are good at either ignoring it or maybe we are good at dealing with it to the extent that it's not shown. Okay, so we are generally quite shy about maybe acknowledging or maybe talking to someone else about mental issues that I am facing. But that can have a lot of bad consequences for our physical health also. And that is why we need to understand mental health and we need to also do something about it. And I think Dr. Prem has also spoken about this. 10th of October was the World Mental Health Day. So the main purpose behind having this day is to create an awareness regarding, the need for treating mental health issues which are there. Okay, and I was just going through, regarding why we generally prioritize, physical health over mental health. Okay, why is it done that way? And, there were three reasons which were given. So the very first, this is that we should be paying attention to our mental health. Why? Because mental disorders account for at least 15% of the global diseases which are there. Okay, so they are, if they are not taken care of, they can have an impact on the physical health also. And they account for around 15% of the global disease burden. Secondly, it says that, they are shaped by contemporary social conditions. Okay, so maybe if I am not treated well, okay, in my home, or maybe I do not get treatment, I am discriminated against, I want to maybe take up a particular job, but I am not encouraged to do that, I am discouraged. So, all these things, socioeconomic forces are also responsible. So that is the second factor why, mental health also needs to be on par with physical health. And the third, this is that mental health issues which are there, their onset or their starting is much more earlier in life than other chronic health conditions. So maybe in the childhood, in adolescence, there are a lot of people who might have mental health issues, but they are brushed under the carpet. We don't take cognizance of it. And that is why they tend to keep on growing. Maybe if we kind of catch them young, or maybe if we do something about it at a young age, they can be dealt with. But generally, this awareness is not there. First of all, awareness is not there. And secondly, there is this stigma which is associated with having a mental health issue. So WHO has said that there is no health without mental health. Mental health is extremely important and it is an integral part of health. And that is something that we need to consider. Okay, so earlier, the WHO had defined mental health as, physical, mental, social, spiritual well-being. But now, the definition is much more broader and it is much more comprehensive. Okay, so how does the WHO define mental health now? And this is not just for young people, this is for everyone. They say that mental health is a state of well-being. Okay, now this well-being is related to our physical health. Or maybe other organizations, or maybe working within a home. So working productively is also associated with mental health. And the fifth important thing is ability to make contribution to his or her community. And this is something that older adults can do very well, contributing whatever they have learned or contributing the knowledge or the experience that they have accumulated over the years for not just themselves, but for their own community. Okay, so this is now the definition of mental health. So these are the different aspects which are included. The first is the state of well-being. Okay, so which is related to the physical health as well as the quality of life. Second is I realizing my own abilities. The third important thing is ability to cope with stresses in life. The fourth is being able to work productively. And fifth is able to make contribution to his or her community. So basically what I'm trying to say is mental health is something, if I'm able, there are so many people with mental health issues. So if I'm able to actually just deal with it, and if that does not hamper, or if that does not come across, or maybe if that does not trouble my daily activities of life, then maybe it is all right. But if it is hampering my daily activities of life, then that is the time maybe I need to go to either a counselor or maybe a psychiatrist, whatever. But I need to take those steps to ensure that I am dealing with or doing something about my mental health issues. And what I'm trying to say is there is nothing to be ashamed about. Now, because we know that, people hesitate to talk about mental health, there are a lot of tips which have been given. So what should I do if I'm very uncomfortable talking about mental health? First is write a letter, okay, regarding what issues I'm facing. So if I don't want to talk face to face, maybe I can write a letter. And now there are so many helplines which are there, and you can talk to them. You can voice out. You can express your grievances. Okay, so write a letter, speak on the phone. Okay, so if you are hesitant to talk about it, talk to someone maybe who doesn't know you. Okay, so a person maybe who doesn't know you, so maybe you can express or you can explain your situation to them. The third important thing is, how do you express if you have any mental health issues? We can start by journaling. So write about it. Write about the issues that I am facing. Okay, and then transition to speaking. So first I can write down exactly pinpoint my problem, and then maybe transition to speaking about it. Fourth is practice speaking in the mirror. Okay, so these are the problems which I have, and how can I actually express these problems in front of someone? So I can practice speaking in the mirror. And we have to remember that there are a lot of, there is this quite a lot of helplines. Maybe I think you have to pay once a month, and twice or thrice a week you can just talk to them regarding the problems that you are facing. So there are a lot of opportunities which are there. There are a lot of helplines which are there. So please do not think that you are alone. Please make use of these helplines and express whatever you are feeling. Don't keep it to yourself. Okay, and loneliness or maybe not talking to people or not expressing yourself. I mean, research has said that loneliness can be so fatal that it is as good as, or that is as bad as, having 15 cigarettes a day. Okay, so it can be so fatal. So loneliness has to be, if I'm feeling lonely, it has to be taken seriously. Okay, and that is what research has been saying. Okay, so I think we have spoken about this, but how do I strengthen my mental health? Okay, so basically social networks are extremely important. Talking to people, mingling with people, doing activities with people is something that is very, very important. And generally in old age, either because I might have physical disabilities or maybe the inability to move out of my home. But, sometimes this social network, maybe you have a social network with Tare Social, and there are quite a few senior citizens associations also in Mumbai. But generally, people in old age feel that, why should I talk to people? I have my own interests. I have my own family. So they don't maybe give so much of importance to it. I'll just give you a small example. There was this lady around 87 years of age when I met her. She's no more. So she used to live in Khar. And this lady was totally immobile. Okay. And immobile in the sense that she was not able to walk. So she used to go on for maybe going to the toilet and, for moving around the house. She had like a wooden plank on which she used to sit, and she used to roll herself throughout the house. So this lady had a lot of problems, and this lady did not have good relations with anyone. So she had a lot of maids who used to come. But you know, all of them used to go away because she, you know, had some or the other problem with them. She did not have any good relations with her family members also. So what I'm trying to say is that she did not pay attention to the fact that some kind of a social network is absolutely necessary. So anyone she used to talk about, she used to criticize them. ये ऐसा है, वो वैसा है, मेरे पास दो भाई आके गई बट उन्होंने मेरे पास चोरी किया, ये मेरे को ऐसा बोल के गई फिर मैंने उसको निकाल दिया. सो यू नो, कॉन्स्टेंटली क्रिटिसाइजिंग, कॉन्स्टेंटली कंप्लेनिंग. सो शी डिड नॉट हैव एनी काइंड ऑफ अ सोशल नेटवर्क एंड शी वॉज फीलिंग एक्सट्रीमली लोनली. ओके, एंड दैट हैड a lot of this on her physical health also. So basically building some kind of a social network, having, it does not matter, I mean, I need not have relations or good relations with 100 people, but in old age it is said that having meaningful relationships is something that is very, very important. So social network is extremely important in old age. Okay, another, this is, and I think we've spoken about that, limited consumption of news. Maybe if seeing a lot of news regarding COVID and, you know, recovery rates have improved and whatever. So if that is something that causes stress, if that is something that causes tension in me, then I must limit the consumption of that news. The third important aspect, which is related to mental health, is having some kind of a purpose in life. And I don't know, maybe I might have spoken about it. There is a wonderful book called Ikigai. Okay, so Ikigai means purpose in Japanese. Okay, so this whole book is regarding how we can have a purpose in life. And they say that we need to find an activity in which there is some kind of a flow. What is meant by flow? By flow, we mean that I must get absorbed in that activity. I must get immersed in that activity. It should be so engaging that I am totally absorbed in it. So having some kind of a purpose, some kind of a ikigai is extremely important. And I think sometime back, I had also told you about this person called Abid Surti. Okay, so I think there is this noise which is there.
No, Amrita, there's nothing. At least I don't hear anything. Is there something at your end happening? Sally, can you mute everybody in case? Well, I don't hear any disturbing sound.
Yeah, Amrita, everything is fine on because of sound. No sound disturbance at our end.
Maybe at your end, yeah.
Okay.
Maybe your network is giving some disturbing sound.
Yeah, yeah. So I think it's saying that my network is unstable. So, okay. Okay, so so as I was saying that this purpose or ikigai is extremely important. And I'm just trying to see whether I have the book. But please, if you get an opportunity, please purchase this book. It is very, very good. And it also kind of suggests ways in which how you can find your own unique purpose in life. Fourth important thing is helping others. So helping others basically gives us a lot of satisfaction. There is a sense of well-being and there is a sense of contentment at maybe helping someone else. So this also leads to strengthening our mental health. And as I said, physical exercise is also extremely important. And physical exercise is also connected with reduced mortality and improved, you know, physical function. So physical exercise is extremely important. And I think I have spoken a lot about mental exercise. So physical exercise is also extremely important. Mental exercising one's brain or maybe mind stimulation is also extremely important. And I have spoken about that if we generally do not do that, then the cells in my brain which are there tend to die. And we see that in diseases like Alzheimer's, the brain generally shrinks. Why does it shrink? Because the cells in the brain tend to die if they are not exercised or activated in any way. Okay, so all these things, social network is extremely important, purpose is extremely important, helping others, volunteering, or maybe doing something for a payment, but maybe doing something. Fourth is physical exercise, and fifth is mental exercise. So all these things are very, very important when it comes to mental health or strengthening mental health. Okay, now regarding a lot of tips have been given, and last time also I wanted to share some of these tips with you, which I could not do because of lack of time. But there are a lot of tips which have been given, you know, regarding better mental health. What can I do? So first, this is make a list. Okay, and generally psychologists say that if I have a lot of worries, if I have a lot of concerns, then put it down on paper. Write it down. Write my worries are. Write what my worries are. And when I make a list, when it is in front of me, then maybe it comes out of my system, and maybe then I can think about ways of dealing with my problems. But constantly, if I just keep on worrying, and just thinking about it, it's not going to help. So make a list of the worries or whatever, the concerns that you might have. So make a proper list. The second, this is practice being more aware. And brain gym is a very important medium through which we can build more awareness. Okay, so practice being more aware and practice paying attention to things which are important. And I think I have spoken about this before, that, you know, Cicero, who was a very, very well-known philosopher, he's written a lot on old age. And he has said that there are two things which are important. If I generally, people talk a lot about in old age, memory loss and not being able to concentrate on certain things. So Cicero said that there are two things which are important. And this is thousands of years back. So the first thing is paying attention. Whatever I want to remember, I must pay attention, be conscious about it. And the second, this is, if I really want to remember something, then I must practice. So these are two important things. And he had said that an older person, an older adult, will never forget where he or she has kept his own treasure. Why? Because this is extremely important. How much money I have, or maybe how much money I have in my bank account, is something that generally people don't forget. Why? Because these things are extremely important. Unless and until I have maybe Alzheimer's or dementia, or maybe some kind of a mental illness. So generally, if I want to remember certain things, and I think we have spoken about exercises like names in the air, lazy eight. So if we do all these exercises, then it can lead to better concentration, as well as also being in the present. Okay, so we need to practice being more aware, being in the present rather than being in the past, or maybe thinking what is going to happen in the future. Okay, so the third, this is test your recall. And I think you play a lot of games regarding that. So maybe even if what they are trying to say is, for better mental health, you need to deliberately give, consciously give your brain some activities. So if you are not participating any kind of activities, maybe you can do this for yourself. Talk about, maybe take 10 words, write it down, and then maybe close that book and then try and remember those 10 words. So how many words are you able to remember out of those 10? So consciously, deliberately give your brain some activity, some stimulus, okay, for it to get activated. Okay, so you have to take conscious efforts for keeping your brain active and your mind healthy. It will not happen on its own. We know for a fact that unless and until I exercise, my body is not going to stay healthy. Unless and until I look after my body, it's not going to stay healthy. So the same goes for my mind as well. And generally, when it comes to New Year resolutions, we generally speak a lot about, you know, I'm going to take care of my health, I'm going to eat better, I'm going to, you know, maybe exercise more often. But are we really emphasizing, or do we really think about, I'm going to maybe look at mental health, or I'm going to work at improving my mental health? Do we say that? Do we really pay attention to that? And that is something that we need to consider. So testing our recall. Draw a map just from our memory. Maybe a library that you have in your neighborhood, or maybe some place, your relative's place. So can we draw a map from memory? Give some work. And, you know, in Hindi we say ke jab tak hamare brain ko hum log koi hamare brain ko humko takleef deni chahiye. Thodi bahut takleef do. Get out of the comfort zone and do something, first of all, which is a little new, and secondly, which is a little bit challenging. Okay, so if I continue to do whatever I've done all my life, then that's not going to challenge my brain. I have to do something that's a little out of the comfort zone, or that is something which offers some kind of a some novelty. Okay, so do maths in my head. So what is 92 plus 92? So just think about it and then do that calculation in your head. So give that work to your brain. Okay, so that's what research is saying. Look for things that you enjoy doing. And that is what in Ikigai, the book, it says that enjoy doing is that flow. So when do you experience that flow? That flow as in things are happening very seamlessly without any problems. So in which activities do I experience that flow? Reading and writing, journaling, writing down what are my feelings, what do I want to do? Do I have a purpose in life? How, if there is a purpose in life, how do I fulfill it? What can I do to achieve my goals? Learning a new language, as I have said, is extremely important. And it has been said that that people who are bilingual, okay, people who are bilingual, it is very likely that they will stay away from Alzheimer's and dementia. Okay, so trying to learn a new language can help making networks in the brain and can help in those whatever synaptic connections, forming synaptic connections in the brain. The networks which are there in the brain are called synapses, and that's why I'm referring to it as synaptic connections, which is the networks that are there in the brain, which are activated when you learn a new language. Playing a new instrument is also extremely beneficial for mental health. And they say playing a new instrument is like, when researchers kind of tried to understand the brain activity which is there, they felt that playing a new instrument is as good as having a total workout, a total brain workout. And they could see that there were like fireworks in the brain when a person tries to learn a new instrument. So it is extremely beneficial for mental health. So we need to try and learn these things, connecting with others and caring for them and picking up a new hobby, which is also very important. And, you know, I think I must have told you about this person. I mean, picking up a new hobby. There was this person who was a banker, and he was a banker for a very long time, maybe 35, 40 years. And just before he got retired, he did a course in photography. It had come in the papers, I think Financial Express or something. So he did a course in photography, and at the age of, I think, 65, after 5 years after he got retired, he visited 6 countries in 5 years. He did that course in photography, which was so good that, he used to kind of have exhibitions almost every year in different countries. Okay, so what I'm trying to say is he picked up this hobby and he did so well that he could visit 6 countries in 5 years, something which he had not done earlier at all. He had not gone out of the country at all. So because of his love for photography, he was able to do this. So picking up a new hobby is extremely important. And I just like to end, with a story regarding how getting out of our comfort zone is very important. So it's just a small story. So there is this thief or robber or criminal who is there. So this criminal has committed many crimes, and he is caught by the king, and he's brought before the king. And the king says that, you know, nothing doing now, you have had committed too many crimes, and there is no pardon for this. And there are two options which you have. So one is death by hanging, and the second option is that you know, there is a huge door, frightening looking door which is there, and you have to face something which is there behind that door. Okay, so I'm not going to tell you what is behind that door, but you have to go behind that door and kind of face whatever is there behind it. So it's quite a frightening looking door. So whatever is there behind it, you will have to face it. So he says, what do you want? Which option do you choose? So this criminal, who is this robber, thief, he says that, okay, death by hanging is something that I will choose. So on the day on which he is going to be hanged, so the king asks him, you know, do you have a last wish? So this thief says that, you know, you told me that there are two options. One is this death by hanging, which you are going to give me right now. And the second option, you said that there is something behind that door. So I'm curious to know what is behind that door. So he says that, he's very curious. He said, please tell me what is behind that door. So he said, no, you have made an option now. So you have to go with whatever you have chosen. He said, no, but at least tell me what is that you are offering? What is behind that door? So he says that if you would have chosen that, then what was behind that door is freedom. If you would have chosen that, maybe I would have set you free. But basically, he did not choose it because he felt that there was something which was very dangerous or something very frightening behind that door. So hence he did not choose that. Okay, so we generally tend to be in our comfort zone and hesitate or are scared to get out of our comfort zone and do something more. Okay, so unless and until we try and do that, we will not understand whether we really enjoy any new activity. So we need to move out of our comfort zone and do something new, novel, which can be very good for our mental health. So thank you very much for listening to me. Thank you.